But just to make it interesting, I think we'll move on to the next one.
There you go.
Okay, so this is the logical problem of evil. Now, again, we're talking about my booklet here. And what I said in here is that basically there's the two fields of science are enough to destroy Christian theology, that is biological evolution and neurology. But there are some Christians who fully accept modern science, and that I think, so for them I would talk about philosophy and say let's go further. And the problem of evil may be seen in two parts. One is moral evil and the other one is natural evil. So for an example of moral evil, my Hitler killing 6 million Jews, and people say, you know, where is God in that? What was God doing? The other one for natural evil would be the things that nature does, like a killer tsunami in the 2004 Indian Ocean that killed hundreds of thousands of people and displaced millions of people. So what I was saying is, if you're an atheist, then this all makes perfectly sense. This is the way the natural world works. But if you believe in an all-good, all-powerful, all-knowing God, then there is no solution to this. And so your response.
But indeed there is. And it's not the end all of the discussion to say, because first of all, there are three things I want to say to that, and I'll try to be quick on these. Number one is that you have made God try to fit your standard, Truman's standard, that God should fix the problems of the world. God should not allow these things to happen. So, and since he doesn't, then he doesn't meet my standards, so therefore he can't exist or he can't be loving. Secondly, that God did create a perfect paradise, if the Genesis account is accurate, that the world was perfect. There was no pain, there was no evil, there were no tsunamis, there was no Hitler. The world was a perfect place, but because sin entered into the world, God allowed the result of sin to have its merit, and he turned nature over to its own merit, and everything went from perfection to chaos. And so what we see now is just any theologian, conservative, evangelical, conservative Christian would say to you that what is going on in the world today is a result of the fall, the result of the entrance of sin into the world. So, number one, you think that God doesn't meet your standard. Number two, you think that it's just an irresolvable issue because God doesn't stop the tsunamis. But then number three, there's a third response, and that is that who's to say where God should stop on his correction of evil? Let's just say that there's a farm, a rancher in Arizona who's allergic to tumbleweed dust, and his whole life he sneezes every day, he constantly has a sinus headache. Well, you know, and he prays and says, God, you know, fix this, you know, and should God fix that? I mean, to him, that's evil. Not long ago, I paid $300 to have a fuel filter replaced on my car. I mean, it should have been nice if God would have just fixed that for me. You know, there are levels of problems, but here's the thing I want you to get, Truman, is this, that if God wiped out every evil in the world, every head cold, every form of cancer, every storm, then we wouldn't know what good is. We wouldn't know what good is. We wouldn't know what love is, because everything would be good all the time. So how can I know what love is if I don't know what evil is? I don't have anything to compare it to. How do I know that I should serve if there isn't a reason to serve? The only reason we serve, my friend, is because someone has a need. They have a problem in their life. It's a bad thing. It could be considered an evil thing that I serve because I'm trying to help them work through that evil. But if God fixed everything, there'd be no need for my desire for service. There'd be no need to help. So, yeah, there are some catastrophic issues. I mean, Category 5 tornadoes and hurricanes wiping out billions and billions of dollars of real estate. That's a bad thing. Every one of us would agree with that. Even Christians have to sit back and say, my God, where are you in this? But in the end, when it's all said and done, we can narrow that down to the ridiculous and say, well, if God's going to stop those kind of things, then he might as well fix my fuel pump while he's at it. He might as well fix my toenail fungus while he's at it, and my gingivitis and all these other things. And so if God is going to do that just for the big things that you consider important, then why not take care of everything too? But if he does, then we will never understand ever what bad is, and we certainly won't know what good is, And how can, because we won't have anything to compare it to. We will all be like Spock on the Starship Enterprise. Everything will just be logical, no emotion, because there is nothing to compare it to.
Okay, well, okay, I'll address some of your comments there. First off, just a general comment is sometimes Christians say, like, well, what is evil? I mean, if you don't believe in God, you don't really believe in evil. And one thing I think is interesting, I didn't really appreciate Christopher Hitchens so much as an atheist spokesperson, but one thing he did say that I liked, and he had a definition of evil, which basically is like bad going off the rails. So in other words, it would be bad to mug somebody, but if you mug them and then you knife them 100 times and then shoot them 50 times and stomp on their body and their face and everything, that's evil, you know. So it's like going the extra mile and just being, you know. So anyway, that's how I'm kind of thinking of this problem of evil, is that, you know, I'm not talking about bad things like I have a backache. I'm talking about tremendous bad things like a tsunami that kills hundreds of thousands of people.
In other words, you want to give God the parameters of what's God or what's bad according to Truman. But to the guy down the street who has a sinus infection and it debilitates him from being able to go to work, to him that is an evil thing. To him that is a bad thing. To him that is bigger than life. So what you're doing is you're trying to categorize the levels of evil, and that's really not fair to the discussion. If God is going to wipe out evil, he needs to wipe out all of it. All of it. You can't just say, I as Truman Smith, get to define what evil is. Evil is evil depending on the context of the person living it.
But I think we can say some things are worse than others. For example, Hitler killing 6 million Jews was a lot worse than the tsunami killing.
But still it's evil just the same.
Right.
It's still a bad thing. Okay. Toenail fungus is a bad thing. To a lot of people.
If toenail fungus was the only problem, though, I don't think atheists would go around saying, like, look at this problem of evil. How do you explain this, you know?
Like I said, with all due candor, you're really stretching. And anybody that uses the problem of evil always have to define what they think evil is. And evil is always contextual, my friend. Your evil might not necessarily be my evil. My pain might not necessarily be yours. But you don't get to define it for me.
Well, actually, Well, the judicial system might do that. I mean, you can't just haul anybody in the court for anything. It's like, well, sorry, this is a crime. But, you know, if you just call somebody a name, they'll say, hey, that's not bad enough to, you know, come in here.
Yeah, but we're talking about God, not the judicial system.
Yeah, but, I mean, these are moral judgments about what's good and bad and justice and what's severe.
But all law-breaking is law-breaking. There's a fine for all of them.
No, there's no fine for calling somebody names, for example. I mean, like, if I cussed you out, okay. Or you cussed me out, I don't think we could get any
problems
for that.
Well, where we're going to part ways, Truman, is on the point of you want to define that there are levels of evil, and I'm going to say that evil is contextual. You know, I have a friend right now who I talk to on a regular basis who has vertigo, and to that particular lady, it is the plague of her life. At least
sure, I understand.
And if God was going to stop the tsunami and going to make her more effective, then why not wipe that out too? I mean,
okay, so
pain suffering is contextual.
Okay, so let me address your points real quickly here. The first one I think you said is, why should God fix these, I think? And one of my comments is that, you know, like if I saw somebody being mugged, you know, especially somebody I really love, like my daughter, you know, if somebody was being mugged and raped and stuff, I mean, I would stop that. I would do what I can. And supposedly God is supposed to be all loving and all powerful, so he would have like a zillion times more affection for this person who's being wronged, you know, brutally murdered and all that stuff than I would. So it's like, if I have enough decency to stop something, you know, why wouldn't God do that?
Right. Well, I didn't say, you know, your question was, you know, why wouldn't God? I didn't say that. I said, if God is going to, then why doesn't he stop all levels of evil? I didn't say, why doesn't God do it? You said that. I didn't. I said, if God is going to stop the tsunami or the rape, then why doesn't he stop the toenail fungus or the sinus infection or the vertigo? It's all contextual.
Okay, so let's look at Hitler, for example. It said that he killed 6 million Jews. Do you think God ever stopped in and did anything? Or... Was God saying like 6 million is okay, 10 million is too much, 2 million is not enough, or did God sit out the whole thing?
You know, the Holocaust was horrible. horrible. But so was the Black Plague that killed what was it, 2/3 of Europe. I mean, and that's something that happened that no person like a Hitler authored. It was just an illness that they say was caused by rats or something like that. You know, it goes back to my first point that when the fall happened, God allowed a perfect system to become a chaotic system. Selfish people became even more selfish. And people like Hitler came along, and Stalin and Mussolini, and these were horrible people in the history of the world. But it doesn't mean that God wasn't there. It doesn't mean that God, if in my perfect world, if I would say, God, why don't you do something? But again, I'm not God. His ways are not my ways. He didn't call me up and say, Tony, now before I allow the Holocaust, let me get your opinion on this. I think there's some things that he knows that you and I don't. Again, to wipe away the idea of God and eternal salvation in heaven because of these evils that happened, and as horrific as they were, again, it's a stretch. Because
okay, so again with Hitler killing, let's say, 6 million Jews, do you think God ever did anything, or did he just say, hey, you know, let's just see what happens?
Well, I don't know what God did or didn't do. I wasn't born then. I believe that there are millions of Jews that survived it who will tell you that God saved them from the Holocaust. There are millions of them, hundreds of thousands, that were able to escape. There are many stories of salvation and victory before their families were murdered. There are stories of the miraculous there that if you would look at that rather than just the evil, that the victories that took place, you'll see that God did indeed intervene in some people's lives. But again, if people are going to be shot in the back of their head by a Nazi, a soldier, that's horrible. And you and I would agree with that. But I'm serving as a summer chaplain right now in a hospital setting. And just yesterday, I watched a 32-year-old woman eaten up with cancer, and she's going to die within the next 48 hours. Why doesn't he stop that, too? You know, that's not any less evil than a soldier shooting an innocent Jew in the back of the head. It's horrible. There are horrible things in this world, and that God allows, but he allows them, my friend, simply because of the fall that took place in the garden. Now,
So you're saying that Hitler killing 6 million Jews is no difference than somebody having cancer?
Not to the person dying with cancer, it's not. It's a horrible.
What about to the independent observer
the family member standing around that hospital bed that I was with just yesterday, and the tears streaming down their faces, and the pain they were seeing for a 32-year-old. Believe me, it was just as horrible for them as Hitler killing a Jew.
How about an independent observer, somebody that doesn't know either family or doesn't know anybody who's being killed, but they see 6 million Jews and they see the other people dying of cancer?
These same people who are independent observers are going to see their own level of evil in their own life. They're either going to suffer from cancer themselves, or they're going to know someone that's dying from it. None of us go through this life in a perfect utopia. And this is what atheists think that God ought to do. God ought to provide a perfect utopia, but what you don't get is that if God did provide that, then we would have no appreciation. God would not be God. He would just be our server. He would be the one that just provided for us a perfect world to live in. We would not understand what love, grace, and mercy is. We would just be logical beings like Spock running around, because we wouldn't know what good and love is, because there was nothing to compare it to.
Yeah, I don't think the atheist...
I can't know what good is unless I first of all know what bad is.
My position isn't that God should create a perfect world. My position is that there's a philosophical inconsistency with believing.
You're mad at God.
No, I think there's I'm just saying, in theology, there's an inconsistency with what people believe and what actually happens in the world. If people actually believe that God is all good, all powerful, all knowing, all everything positive, but yet what we see in life is this doesn't add up with that. There's an internal inconsistency. But, you know, if you're an atheist, there's no inconsistency. What you see is what you get, and that's what you would expect.
Well, inconsistency, though, is both good and bad. Inconsistency is chaos, of course, because none of us see everything exactly the same. It's also good because it shows us our differences and our diversity, and that we do see the world differently and how the world operates from a different perspective.
But when it comes to philosophical inconsistencies, I mean like this. It's not adding up with reality. For example, you could say, I believe in Santa Claus and he delivers presents all over the world, but you'd say, wait a minute, in real life that's physically impossible, so that'd be a philosophical inconsistency.
Well, of course it would be. It's also, but we also know that that's a non-truth. We know where that came from. We know where the idea of Santa Claus comes from. We can trace its history to its beginning points. So that it's a poor analogy because we always have known that it was a myth. To relate that to God is just frankly quite silly. We don't know all of our origins. We don't know where everything came from. We can only speculate based upon science and theology and philosophy. But none of us can dogmatically assert that I know this is true like you do in your document, because you don't know. None of us in our humanness can quote infallibility.
Well, okay.
Or claim infallibility.
Now let me back up a little bit and talk about, this is called the problem of evil. Now, what I did in my booklet is I said, first off, there's two reasons in science. There's biological evolution and neurology, and that's enough to blow away theology. But yet there are some theologians who fully accept modern science. And so I'm saying to them, for them, let's go forward now and look at philosophy. So now when you look at the philosophy, we have this problem of evil. And for example, you said, well, I think the fall explains a lot of things. But this fall is not an answer for these people who accept the modern science, because with evolution, that means there is no Adam and Eve. There was no first humans.
Right.
And so basically one of your main defenses is blown out of the water for anybody who fully accepts evolution. And so, for example, with people at the Biologos, all these Christians who accept evolution fully, I have not seen any good answers from them at all. In fact, the biggest defense they usually give is the free will defense. And as I spoke in the book, the Bible even speaks against that. It's like, sorry, you can't use that defense because God, it says in there, God is a potter. He can make people for whatever he wants to.
Truman, I can play that same card with you. You don't have any good answers either. You have a theory. You have a speculation. You have what you think the evidence shows. And again, you've missed my point earlier. None of us who are honest are going to debate science and the results of science with you and scientists seriously. We're going to say that the evidence of science does suggest certain things, but it doesn't necessarily suggest what you think it does. But at the same time, there's another part of our humanity. We're not just rational thinkers in our intelligence. We're also philosophical. We're also spiritual. We're also hopeful for something beyond this life. And atheistic biological evolution offers no hope. So therefore, it is innate within human nature to reject it, regardless of the evidence. And that's not dishonest. That's not them saying, well, the evidence isn't true. It's them trying to grapple with their spiritual aspect of who they are, their ability to reason, and their honest intellect with the science. So what I'm talking to you about is a wholeness of both, all aspects of my personality and my being, my spiritual, my emotional, my intellectual, my philosophical. All you're talking about is rational, and to you everything is just rational. But to those billions of people out on the face of the earth who practice some form of religion, to them it's not about rational. Everything isn't rational. Everything is about, can be rational and intelligent, but it's also emotional and spiritual and hope beyond this life, and something that says there's love behind the evil of the world, there's a purpose to it, that everything happens for a reason, that something is far beyond our control, and we hope that this life isn't all there is. And we look at the evidence and we see signs of that. We can see stories of the miraculous and so forth. We can hear testimonies of people that have been ultimately blessed by what they consider to be the acts of God. I can tell you my own story.
Let me do some more of my responses here, though. First, I want to try to have some equal time.
Okay.
Equal time on this.
I think I've been pretty fair.
Okay. For the people who perfectly accept modern science, and I'd refer to somebody like Francis Collins, who wrote The Language of God. He's an evangelical Christian, and he says, evolution is a fact, and let me show you why in my book. I don't think they have an answer for this problem of evil. And, for example, the answer you gave about Adam and Eve and the fall, they would not give that because they don't believe in Adam and Eve. They think it's a myth. It wasn't not a literal, creation story. So that's my only point that I wanted to give to you about the fall is, like, sure, you know, if you're a young earth creationist or an old earth creationist, you can blame things on the fall, but I would say if you accept modern science, then you have to see the fall as a figurative thing, and it never happened, so that's not an answer to bring forward.
Well, okay, but again, for you to say that doesn't, to use your words, wipe it away. It's just your opinion based upon what you read and what you think is rational truth. Now, there are different interpretations of the fall and different understandings of it, but the bottom line is that you and I will agree on this. There are bad things in the world. You and I just disagree on where those bad things come from, where evil comes from. You know, I believe it's a result of mankind being wicked and rebellious against the purpose of God. You believe it's just innate in human nature to kill each other.
Well, wait a second. So if there's the Indian 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami that killed hundreds of thousands of people and displaced millions, do you think that came from the fall, or is that just tectonic plates? You know,
I think it came from tectonic plates, but God allowed the tectonic plates to shift and cause massive tsunamis and earthquakes and horrible things as a result of him turning over a perfect creation to a chaotic creation that was the choice of man by being rebellious against the plan of God.
So do you think before the fall of Adam and Eve there was no earthquakes?
I do. But it didn't take long.
Well, you know,
the fall to happen. It was absolutely perfect.
Well, here's another thing, too, that, you know, supposedly when God created Adam and Eve and said, you know, everything is good, there are some people, too, who say, well, you know, Adam and Eve, because of their sin, they ushered in death into the world. But there's a counterpoint that you need to have death, because if you don't have death, the world would not be sustainable. We'd have people walking over each other. I mean, there'd be no room to even walk one step.
I agree.
So in order to be sustainable, you would have to have death. That means if creation is good, it would have to be sustainable, which means you have death. And so it wouldn't make sense to say creation is good without death.
No, you don't have any argument with me on that. But as far as how
far population goes. But you think death didn't come in, but you would say that death didn't come in until the fall of Adam and Eve. So if Adam and Eve didn't sin, that would have been better, maybe, right?
Well, I don't know what God's plan was beyond it. Say the fall did not happen. There might have been a time when he said, okay, there's enough people and there's enough of this human world. We're just going to go on into an eternal place anyway, and that'll be the end of it. I don't know. I can't address that because I have no definite answer on that. Still doesn't minimize the point that I'm trying to make. And which the point that I'm trying to make is, as all of the evidence that you have in your corner, and I have conceded that there are many points of science that we cannot contest, that we have to deal with, it does not therefore mean, though, that God is not there and that he didn't author some of it or even all of it. It does not mean that there is no God because science points in a certain direction. That's just a huge leap on the part of those who are atheists. And it's also extremely fatalistic, and it is against human nature that has the desire for significance and purpose. Atheism offers no purpose outside of daily existence.
Yeah, I don't really want to get into the purpose. It's not that I'm just involved only in the rational part. It's more like I think we have to take this into two steps. The first step is what is truth? And first, let's define what the truth is. And then number two, how do we deal with it? And whether something's fatalistic or not is part of number two, how you deal with it. And I don't really want to talk about that just because I don't think we have time for it. So I think the first part is just trying to determine what is true, for example, evolution or, you know, do we have a soul and that kind of stuff. But let me say one more thing about this problem of evil. There's the Bible verse, I think it's Colossians, I can't remember, but it says that basically God holds everything together. And that's another whole complication to this, is that when there's a tsunami that kills 100,000 of people, that tsunami would not be possible without God holding it together in that circumstance. So does God hold only the good things together, or does God hold everything together? The Bible says everything, which would make him, you know, this mass murderer killer guy.
Well, I don't know how many of our listeners understand the word exegesis, but you do as a seminarian. And that's poor exegesis on your part, and I think you know it. You know, the holding together doesn't mean isolated things here and there. It means that he holds the entire purpose of his creation together, that in spite of the good and the bad, in spite of the evil, the cancer, the tsunamis, the tornadoes, the hurricanes, in spite of the toenail fungus or whatever else, everything God holds together for the ultimate revelation of his purpose, which is, in Colossians, the magnification and the glory of his Son, the Lord Jesus. That's what Colossians is about. It's the entire book is a treatise of the majesty of who Jesus is, and so he is holding everything together so that as many will have the opportunity to come to know Christ will, and will understand him in his glory one day. So your exegesis is sadly weak, and I'm sorry for that because you're a graduate of our school.
No, but I think we agreed completely, because what I said was that according to that Bible verse, when there's that 2004 tsunami that killed hundreds of thousands of people, that was only made possible.
You're just rephrasing the question. I'm going to say the same thing again. Your exegesis of Colossians 1 is very poor. You don't understand the context of the purpose of Colossians.
Okay, just allow me to, just 10 seconds.
Go ahead.
That is, that earthquake, that tsunami would not have happened unless Jesus held it together. So Jesus held that tsunami together, and that's why it killed hundreds of thousands of people. Okay, if it wasn't for Jesus...
Just for the sake of our listeners, I'm just going to tell them to rewind this and listen to what I said before, because I'm just going to say what I said before. Your exegesis and understanding of the Colossians is incredibly weak, and that's all I can say. If a New Testament professor was sitting here instead of me, he would be much harsher with you than I am.
Well, okay. Well, I was hoping to have some dialogue over it, but
You can dialogue all the way, but your premise is flawed. And if your premise is flawed, then the rest of your argument is weak as well.
But I think we have an agreement, though, that Jesus holds it all together.
Agreed. But he holds it together for a purpose grander than holding off tsunamis.
Okay, but it sounds like we agree on the premise, though.
What we disagree on is what he holds together. You're saying,
but we both agree.
You're saying that if he holds everything together, there won't be any bad. There won't be any tsunamis. There won't be earthquakes. I'm saying he holds things together in spite of the fact that there are tsunamis and earthquakes. That his purpose of the revelation of his Son Jesus is why everything is held together by God, in spite of the evils of the world.
Okay, well, we have a disagreement there over
of course we do
some things. Okay, let me see if we have any comments here. I'm not